Satya, great to have you here, and a warm virtual welcome for Satya Misra of HCL. Over to you, Satya.
Greetings, everyone, and thank you for joining today. I see a large number of people joining across the globe. I'm really thrilled to be part of this virtual seminar now. I'm going to present, like Steve said, how to drive your digital transformations with a high-speed delivery model, especially in a SaaS world, which is anything and everything as a service, especially when you use IT for IT reference architecture. Right. So today, in next 25 minutes or so, what we're going to talk about is what is really changing in IT service management with respect to digital transformations. And then we will talk about the four pillars of the digital service management, and then we will also touch upon how and why the IT for IT is more important from a digital transformation perspective. And then we will talk about where to start if you want to start implementing IT for IT journey. And at the end, we will touch upon a case study as well. My introduction has already been done. I'm currently working in HCL Technologies and having engaged in doing a lot of development work in terms of products and services in the SaaS service management in IT for IT open IT for IT open group. I'm part of the steering committee and adoption group. And that's about my short descriptions, and let's get going. Just to very briefly on the digital transformation, as you can see in this slide, it depicts that some of the statistics about digital transformation and its adoption level in various industry verticals. The study indicates that some of the industry verticals such as media, retail, telecom, insurance, and banking, they already have started adopting digital transformations. But some of the industry are in the process of starting, or they are in mid of deciding about their transformation journey. But what is the interesting fact is that the study reveals that 70% of such digital transformation initiatives will not reach to the stated objectives, and then 16% of such initiatives has given performance benefit. All such indicates that the digital transformation is not so successful. And why it is so, right? It is very important for us to understand. Well, while the business sees the opportunities in adapting the digital transformations, but at the same time, business alone cannot achieve it in isolation. So the IT has to be partner to it, and they also need to adapt a new ways of working in order to support these digital transformations. And this slide actually talk about how the IT paradigm has been shifting and how the service management is coping up with those development or changing in the technologies. So back in year 2000, when the most adapted framework of service management ITIL was implemented, right? That time, the IT operating model was more technology centric. And the CMDB remained the center of universe of IT service management. Slowly, the technology emerges. The business wanted more collaboration with IT, and that's where we entered into a business-centric IT operating model, and a service portfolio-based IT service management system was introduced. But if you look at the current status in the digital transformation or digital world, right, we need a consumer-centric IT operating model, where the service catalog remains the center of universe. So all your conventional or traditional service management framework is not going to be relevant anymore. So we need to adopt a new service management framework, which is more digital in nature. And something like IT for IT and progressive service management concept will help you to establish that. I mean, to carry the same argument forward, you see that the traditional IT service management has given very little focus on the IT service fulfillment systems. If you put some mathematical calculation, it will come around 4%. But when you compare that to any of the digital service management framework, it has given a complete quadrant of 25% to the request to fulfill or request management systems. That's how the things have been changed. In the digital service management, it is more consumer-centric, and it allows the anything and everything as a service concept much more in practical sense. Now, to implement a digital service management, what are the guiding principles? How do you enable the digital transformations? When and what are the key attributes of a digital transformation, digital service management as a framework? Like I said, first of all, we need to transform from the technology or business-centric IT operating model to a consumer-centric IT operating model. And for that, the SaaS service management remains one of the very, very important and critical aspects. So you need to have the entire your fulfillment system based on SaaS service management operating model. Then the velocity becomes another important aspect. So your processes needs to be more agile. There needs to be more adapting to the to the fulfillment systems and support how quickly you can turn around the things into the productions, but not by compromising the compliance. You need to ensure that the compliance are met, but all your policies are not IT centric. It has to be business centric, and the velocity can also be achieved by having the technology capabilities such as the emerging technologies, in the sense the chat ops or the cloud native tools or features will enable your SaaS systems more agile and more quick as the business is expecting us to deliver. Now, there is agile ways of working is another important thing. The moment we think about agile, the first thing that comes to our mind is DevOps. But DevOps and IT service management cannot really work in silos or two different islands. So we need to have a harmonized process working together in tandem to deliver the services. The taxonomies, the terminologies that we use and the roles that we have in different process framework or that needs to be harmonized and to have a common unified process model. And at the same time, to have a consumer-centric IT operating model, we need to have an integrated catalog. That remains a fundamental of consumer-centric IT operating model, because unless you have your products and services hosted in the catalog systems, it won't be available to the consumers to consume it. So it essentially means that you need to consolidate all the services and products that is offered from your, not just from the IT, but also its partner and suppliers to have one consolidated systems. And it should allow the consumer to select the services which is more appropriate and fit for the purpose, and go ahead and order for those service. But it also need to ensure that your catalog should also facilitate the insights like usage, chargeback, showback, IT financial management, etc., to ensure that your system is completely supporting the system of engagement. And then another important aspect is the automations, because until you have the automation in place in your entire fulfillment lifecycle, you will never be able to achieve the speed that the business wanted us to deliver the services. Now, in the mean of doing the automations or the automated fulfillment, we also need to ensure that the compliance is not getting compromised. Something like the tagging policy of virtual assets, or this is just an example, but there are so many things that you need to take care while doing the your process automations. And when we talk about a SaaS environment, we end up having multi-supplier environment, right? When we have more than one supplier supporting to your services. In such a situation, the service integration and management and your orchestration engine has to work in tandem to ensure that your full end-to-end fulfillment system is completely orchestrated across. For example, let's say a consumer comes and asks for an entire environment provision in a click of a button. And how do you ensure that? There might be a dozens of activity that needs to be triggered. So all such activities are to be algorithmically fit into your orchestration engine and trigger it on a click of a button from the engagement portal so that it has a seamless fulfillment system as a background process. And now having all that done is not sufficient. What you need to do is also establish a governance and a management framework, and which is very, very imperative from a total insight perspective and from a cost perspective, right? You want to reduce the number of approvals. You don't want to put a lot of decision gates and make the processes bureaucratic. You want to have them as thin as possible, and also enables with the insight that the consumer and the business can see what are they subscribing for and how much of them is more relevant, so that they can surrender the irrelevant subscriptions. Well, having said that, what is that you need? to establish a digital service management. I say that there are four ingredients which is very, very important that you need to adopt from a digital service management perspective. The first thing is JaaS. Like I said, you need to have an operating model which is totally aligned to the JaaS, where everything is available to its consumer as a services. And the second thing that you need is DevOps. DevOps is nothing but an enabler for the JaaS model. It will ensure that the idea is converted into a product and services as quick as possible in an iterative way. And then automations remains the heart of it, because until you do the automations end to end of your fulfillment systems, it will delay the fulfillment life cycle. So need to ensure that automation plays a very vital role, and all your cloud native or JaaS native automations tools are integrated to each other. And then finally, you also need to have an AI ops. Once the services are offered, consumed, and is available in the operations, entire your operations also needs to be digitally transformed. That essentially means that your operations can sense automatically the proactive events and resolve it automatically by using the capabilities of machine learning, artificial intelligence, cognitive assistance, etc. So this is how you can drive your digital transformations. Now, in order to do that, what is exactly you need, right? You need to have a process framework such as DevOps and ITIL4 will help you to create a process which is designed for digital, and both of them together needs to be implemented. That essentially means that you need to translate it into the tools. And IT4IT is the reference architecture which provides the prescriptive guidelines which you can stitch all your data points to create a system of record in terms of your entire, taking the requirement to run the services, right? And IT4IT, those who are new to IT4IT, it's a value streams based IT reference architecture which which enables the IT to run as a business, and it has four value streams: strategy to portfolio, works as in the planning level, takes the requirement from business, enterprise architecture and policy, and get them the requirement now handed over to the DevOps for the development of the products and services before it hosted as a catalog item in the request to fulfill, where the consumer comes and consume their services from the catalog, and then it becomes ready for consumption. Once it is consumed, then it becomes an operation items where the detect to correct run the operations in a long term. Right. So if you have decided to implement the IT4IT allow you to build your ecosystem in a more pragmatic approach, where you can actually, it means that you may decide that what is more priority, what is that is more resonating to the current issues. What is the target area you want to resolve first, right? What is the current CIO's problems which you want to resolve? So you can choose what you want and deploy that. In a SaaS delivery model, let me tell you that what is more important. S2P is a logical step, but it's not very imperative from a CIO perspective, because it's something that can be done later. But R2D is something that is being taken care of once you have implemented DevOps. B2C, you can have it in any form of ITL implementation or AIOps that can be achieved. What is more disruptive in a SaaS environment or a consumer-centric IT operating model is R2F. R2F was not present in any of the previous framework. This becomes an absolutely imperative to start, and it becomes a natural choice of selections. Right, let me take you through a case study. So HCL has done many projects of implementation of IT4IT based solutions. So let me quickly take you to one of such interesting case study of a retailer, global giant who is 25 billion revenue, has presence across almost everywhere in the globe, has different business units accessing the IT services. They have engaged HCL to redefine their IT operating model to have a cloud office which will drive and control and establish governance to maintain the transparency and traceability of a cloud services that has been offered to its consumer. And the customer has already deployed DevOps in some form, and they already had a traditional IT service management. They have a defined strategies of cloud first and one day to production strategy, but despite having those ambitious strategies, their operating model is too much of traditional and bureaucratic. And the ways of working is not aligned to the agile ways of working. The DevOps consumers are really struggling to get the meaning or to get the right services from the IT. Now, when we actually zoom into their problem statement in little detail, we found that the catalog is totally distributed. The consumer has to actually browse through multiple catalog items in a different database. The chargeback showback was a daunting task because it is the cost center is not really mapped to the resources. There is no defined process of doing a chargeback to the business. There was no clear meaning of what is direct cost, indirect cost, what is shared cost, and the actual subscriptions. Then there were multiple channels and protocols where the consumers can come and consume the services. It's like the engagement with the consumer is again very distributed. The KPIs were very traditional. There is no measurement of cloud specific KPIs and lack of fulfillment transparency and traceability, because in the sense that the consumer has to actually chase multiple fulfillers for a single services, and they are really confused in that area. So there were a lot many issues that were recognized in their current systems. So how we have achieved HCL, and we do it in almost every engagement. So we understand the customer pain points. We do a thorough pre-study and understand their gaps within their current operating model, understand what is the need of improvement with respect to tools, processes, governance, people, and then we try to resolve them one by one in approach which we call that as build as a product and deliver as a service. So in the sense that what we do is that, whatever the real adjustment that needs to be done with their existing products and services, we do that adjustment there and there, and also bring our own products and services to make the customer implementation done end to end. Well, after the implementation, this is how it looked like. Let me quickly take you through the how the reference architecture works in tandem. So when we talk about a cloud office, it is the consumer is really DevOps users or application development communities, business user or IT architect. They have been facilitated with an engagement portal, and that is having all the facilities that you usually see in an e-commerce website. For example, a shopping cart, or they can compare the services coming from or sourced from the different cloud service provider. They actually compare from a cost perspective, attributes perspective, a utility warranty perspective, which is more fit for their purpose. They select the one and then go ahead and order that services. If they do not find that service in the catalog, they can really embark or get an engagement to the catalog manager and do a rapid add with the help of a cloud architect. The cloud architect actually can go to the market and see what are the various options available as an external service provider or internal private cloud, and rapidly add that services if that is found as a solutions and make it available in the catalog. Then the consumer can access the services and order for the services that they need. This is one entry point. The other entry point that we had is that the business directly coming to the service portfolio manager and asking for a new service or enhancement to the existing services. In that case, the portfolio manager takes that business requirement, add those policy requirement in terms of your cloud policies, organization policies, legal policies, statutory policies, and the enterprise architecture input or the requirement into the business requirement, and make it as a holistic end-to-end requirement before it is handed over to the DevOps team. DevOps team picks that requirement, runs the development lifecycle, convert that English requirement into a product or services, and with the help of catalog manager, host it into the service catalog. then it is available for the consumer to consume it. The consumer then accesses that the services, and once it is submitted, the order routing engine actually takes that request, decompose it, and make it sub-request, for the fulfillers to fulfill that services. In between, that order engine will use the fulfillment execution, which in turn use the automation engine in the orchestrations to orchestrate the multiple activity then spread across multiple suppliers to fulfill that service as a background processes without being the consumer has to approach to the multiple service fulfillers. And also it is important that we should provide all the insights with respect to the managed subscriptions. You know, one of the insights which the consumer can use it to see that what are the subscriptions that they're currently using. The service usage will tell you the capacity perspective, the higher limit, lower limit, the usage in terms of the compute as well as the cost. And chargeback showback will really enable the IT to actually charge back to the business that they are consuming for. And once it is consumed, it is handed over to the operations to run the services in the productions. Well, this is a typical the IT reference architecture how it looked like after the implementations. And this is what is the key outcome post the implementation. We achieved 1-day productions. We have developed a cloud service catalog, which is an aggregation of all the services that was offered from the various partners and IT themselves. We changed their processes. We cloudified their existing processes. We also developed new processes by incorporating the various roles of the cloud supply chain, and also developed the functional requirements specifications for the various tools across the supply across the fulfillment lifecycle to ensure the interoperability is being achieved. And governance reporting becomes another important aspect to ensure that the proper insight is given to the business and consumer to take the corrective actions in terms of the cost optimizations. Accounting and cost optimization becomes another important aspect with respect to chargeback and showback, and which establishes a complete systematic approach where the IT has to recognize the need and then transfer or charge back to the business for the services they are using for. That's how you achieve the IT to run as a business. Eventually, what we have achieved is that one-touch fulfillment for all its consumers for the variety of services that it is to offer. As a result of which, we had a lot of qualitative or quantitative benefits. The unaccounted cost reduced by 100%. Every resources are now accounted, tagged, and is available for accounting purpose. 100% of the cloud service requests now are tracked and traced, and the traceability and transparency was achieved. Reduction in the OPEX and CAPEX, and as well as the consumer efficiency was increased by 50%. There are many other. I took little more than the allocated time. That's really it from my side at this point of time. Thank you so much for bearing with me.
Sacha, thank you so much. It's great to see the case study and talking through the relevance. We have for IT in particular. We have a couple of slides. I'll be quick so that we don't eat into Lars's time too much. But first question that came in quite early, slide 10 shows many areas that we need to deliver in order to enable digital transformation. For organizations who are just starting this journey, is there a suggested priority instead of all at once?
It all depends that what is the CIO's, main issues or they are facing and what is the priority. So IT for IT is a completely pragmatic approach. So what we suggest is that R2F becomes a natural choice if you are doing a digital transformations, because a lot of the abilities of converting these services and make it available as a package solutions and offer to the consumers, IT for IT enables that very quickly.
Right. Okay. Thank you. And very quickly, what is the difference, or can you say some of the differences between IT for IT and SAFe version 5?
SAFe version 5 and IT for IT, I'm not an SME for the SAFe, but IT for IT is definitely one of the reference architecture which embraces all its next-gen concepts. For example, if you have any DevOps or Agile concept, or like Safe Agile, you can actually run that into any of, if you have implemented IT for IT, Safe Agile becomes very easy for the implementations. So it ensures that your record of reference is created and all your integration is established to ensure and to support your Safe Agile implementation as well.
Right. Okay, great. Thank you. We're right on time. Satya, thank you for your presentation today and for your work inside the Open Group and particularly the IT for IT forum. So virtual round of applause for Satya Misra. Thank you, Satya.